Hi everyone, welcome. Today we're here to do another GIA Knowledge Session. These are a series of talks and seminars about gemology that are fueled by our decades of research here at GIA. We consider ourselves very fortunate. We get to study so many gems and diamonds, and it's really our mission to share these discoveries with you. So I'm excited to start today. I'm Dr. Mike Breeding, a scientist here at GIA, and I'm joined by Dr. Evan Smith, who's also a research scientist. Today, he's going to talk to us about a very interesting sort of volcanic elevator, you might say, known as kimberlite, and the role that it plays in getting diamonds from where they form deep in the earth up to the earth's surface, where they can be mined and ultimately come to jewelry stores and into our hands. So it's kind of interesting because we talk so much about gem diamonds and other gemstones, but it's really fun when we can step back and look at some of the other geology and the rock associated with them and the role that it plays in getting them into our hands. So before we get started, a little bit of housekeeping. So everyone is automatically muted. If you have a question, please submit it using the question and answer feature. You'll see that at the bottom of your screen. You can ask questions as we go, and I encourage that. Otherwise, feel free to ask them at the end as well. There will be a Q&A session after Dr. Smith speaks, where he'll answer a few of the questions that you've given. So with that, I'll pass it over to Evan and enjoy.
Thank you, Mike. And thank you to all of you for tuning in. I'd like to introduce you to kimberlites. These are the volcanoes that carry diamonds. Now, most people are used to looking at diamonds like this, these placid pools of light sparkling in all their beauty, and we have them in beautiful pieces of jewelry. It's sometimes hard to appreciate their past, that these have all been actually blasted up to surface in these gassy, violent volcanic eruptions. So all the diamonds we have in jewelry have actually come up to surface in these quite pronounced eruptions called kimberlites. So these are volcanoes. Now, we probably have an idea of what volcanoes are. Here's a volcano. This is Mount Pinatubo. Here's another volcano. This is a still image from a video taken just 5 days ago in Iceland. There's some really spectacular drone footage showing this lava pouring out here. And this is probably what a lot of people would think of when we think of volcanoes. If you ask anybody to draw what's a volcano, they would probably draw something like this with orange hot blobs of lava spewing out. So is this sort of what we're thinking of? Does this contain diamonds? Is this the elevator that brings diamonds up to surface? And the answer is no, not really. These volcanoes that I just showed you, and many of the volcanoes all around the world, these are not the kinds of volcanoes that bring diamonds up to surface. So here's a map of the world, and we've got two main kinds of volcanoes that are sort of potentially active right now, things that are in the middle of tectonic plates, these like hot spots, like the Hawaiian Islands, for instance. And then we've also got volcanoes like all these red dots all the way around the perimeter of the Pacific Ocean. This is the so-called Ring of Fire. So globally, we've got maybe 1,500 different volcanoes that are potentially active. I mean, potentially active, like they know they're supposed to get cardio 3 times a week, but they just don't have the time. But these are volcanoes that might erupt, but none of these are kimberlites. None of these are the kinds of things that bring diamonds up to surface. If we look at what causes these volcanic eruptions, these are so-called arc volcanoes, because sometimes they form these arc shapes here. What's happening in these arc volcanoes that are so prevalent? We have the oceanic plates that are sort of migrating slowly across the ocean floor. And at these plate boundaries, the ocean plates are subducted. They're sort of brought down into the earth. And they often bring a little bit of water with them that sort of fluxes some magmatic activity. And this is all happening shallower, for the most part, shallower than about 100 kilometers. And this is a place where we really don't expect diamonds to be forming. And even if they did form here, they're probably going to be destroyed during this magmatic activity that's relatively slow So diamonds have a lot of chance to be destroyed, and it's relatively oxidizing. So if you had diamonds here, they would probably be transformed into CO2 or carbonate, and you would never see them at surface. So this is a place where we don't form diamonds, and they wouldn't be preserved if they were. So what kinds of volcanoes are we actually talking about that blast diamonds up to surface? The answer is kimberlites. So these are a totally different kind of volcanic eruption. And this is a really nice sort of artistic picture of what one looks like. And this is a more schematic geological kind of picture showing the different forms that we see deep underground. And what's different about a kimberlite is that it erupts from a much greater depth. So we're talking about maybe beyond 200 kilometers depth. And this is something that erupts through the middle of the oldest and thickest parts of continents where we think diamonds form at the bottom. So this is a kind of magma that can sweep past this diamond window and pick up diamonds and bring them up to surface. And it transports them relatively quickly. So some of the diamonds that are in that magma can be preserved all the way up to surface. So what do these rocks look like? Here's a really nice example of, so this is a polished slab of kimberlite. This is something called hypabyssal kimberlite. So this kimberlite hasn't actually been erupted at surface yet. So it actually has maintained a lot of its sort of most quintessential features without being modified too much. And the first thing you might notice is that it's full of all these pale green blobs. These are crystals of olivine. So kimberlite is a very olivine rich rock. And then the other thing it has is all this very fine grained gray material. And a lot of this is sort of the more magmatic components of the kimberlite itself. So how did we get to kimberlites? I mean, they haven't been known for very long. A couple hundred years ago, no one had ever seen a kimberlite or knew anything about it. And the way we got to kimberlites was by looking for diamonds. Diamonds and kimberlites go hand in hand. We would probably never have found kimberlites and really studied them in any detail if it wasn't for diamonds. So let's go back and look at diamond mining. So diamond mining has been going on for thousands of years. And the earliest diamond mining was probably in India over 2000 years ago. And this was the world's only sort of major source of diamonds for a very long time. Another major source of diamonds that sort of might have augmented that supply is in Borneo, the island of Borneo, and specifically the province of Kalimantan, so the southern part of the island of Borneo. And we're not quite sure when diamond mining began there. It might have been earlier than the 1500s. Some people speculate as early as 600 AD. A little bit later than this, diamonds were found in Brazil. People who were panning for gold started noticing some of these beautiful crystals that later turned out to be diamonds. And then they were panning not just for gold, but actively trying to recover some of these diamonds as well. So all of this diamond mining activity for over 1,000 years was exploiting secondary deposits. So these are diamonds that have been washed out of some kind of original host rock that was not known and washed along with pebbles and sand and accumulated in river deposits or in beach gravels. These are the kinds of deposits people knew about. And it wasn't until just after 1866, following the discovery of South Africa's first diamond, the Eureka diamond. So after 1866, people started looking for diamonds in South Africa. And 5 years after that first diamond was discovered, people found diamonds that were actually situated in a weird kind of rock, a rock that was later known as kimberlite. So the rock was actually a primary host rock for the diamonds. And this is what provides the diamonds that are washed out into secondary deposits. So this rock, where diamonds appear as a primary crystal within that, this rock was mined for a few years before they named it. They had to give it a special name because they had never seen it before. And it was named kimberlite after this place where it was first discovered in Kimberley, South Africa. And this is an image. So remember, they found some of these first deposits around 1871. By 1872, you can see the enormous amount of digging that has gone on just by hand to extract some of this primary source rock to recover diamonds. And not long after that, in 1889, this same mine, this is the Kimberlite mine, was sort of mined right down into a big hole. And it looks a lot like this today. This is the so-called big hole in Kimberlite. You can find it. It's a big tourist attraction. It's kind of an interesting historic place to see. And the bottom of this pit is now filled in with water. But for the most part, this whole mine was extracted by hand, which is a pretty incredible feat. And this is sort of a volcanic pipe that would have once been occupied by this kimberlite material. So this is, in essence, a kimberlite volcano that's now been extracted for its diamond content. And this similar kind of open hole or open pit is what we see in a lot of modern day diamond mines. Here is an aerial image of a mine in northern Canada called Diavik. And we've got these sort of spiral looking holes that go into the ground. And these are, you can see an access road here for haul trucks to come down into this pit and haul out material. And the actual kimberlite itself occupied the middle of this pit and this pit here. On the left, you can see a more schematic diagram showing in red what these kimberlites look like. And this is pretty typical of a kimberlite volcano. It has this sort of downward tapering structure like a carrot. And this has been extracted through these open pit mines. And then this has actually been advanced to an underground mining stage here. So what you can see in green here, these are all sort of roadways and tunnels that will be constructed underground. And this mining continues today underground beneath these pits to continue extracting this kimberlite material. Here's another example of a large open pit mine. This is Orapa. And you can see the kimberlite here by its color. So a lot of the sort of surrounding country rocks are reddish in color. These are basalts, but in the middle, you can see this dark greenish color. And the greenish color is actually the kimberlite itself. So you can see these regions here where they're digging out this kimberlite material, loading it up into trucks and driving it up to a processing plant. So the material that they're actually mining at these mines, the kimberlite, can look something like this. So these are these chunks of rock and the texture is very mixed. It's got these sort of big grains of olivine and a lot of stuff in between. And they can often have big chunks of other rocks called xenoliths that have been mixed in with the kimberlite magma. And if we're lucky, sometimes the kimberlite has these diamonds embedded in it. Here are some diamonds that have been liberated from the kimberlite, but these often make good collector specimens. If you have a kimberlite still in, or a diamond still embedded in a chunk of kimberlite, it's especially appreciated by geologists like me. Now, the diamonds themselves have an interesting relationship with the kimberlite. Initially, when people found this kimberlite rock, this primary host rock, and the diamonds inside them, it was assumed that the diamonds had grown out of the kimberlite magma, i.e. they would be phenocrysts, so that the magma had cooled to some point and you started forming a crystal of diamond from that magma. But it turned out that's not really the case. Diamonds are not phenocrysts, they are xenocrysts. And xeno here means stranger or foreign. So these are crystals that are sort of foreign to the magma. They haven't actually grown from the magma. Diamonds do not crystallize from the kimberlite magma. And this is an idea that took a long time to prove. It was a hotly debated subject for many years. But one of the things that really shows this well is the inclusions inside diamonds. So here's sort of a cross section down into the earth and maybe at a depth of 150 to 200 kilometers. Now we know this is where diamonds are crystallizing. So imagine a diamond crystallizing down at this depth. It gets bigger and it envelops some neighboring mineral grain. This is an inclusion. It's trapped inside the diamond and it bears witness to the time and place where this diamond has grown. And then if this diamond is transported up to surface as a xenocrist, we can see this diamond, we can see its inclusion, and we can see other pieces of material, other xenocrysts that were once down at this depth, sort of formed in tandem with diamond or existing, pre-existing around this place where the diamond grew. So we can see xenocrysts and xenoliths, actual chunks of rock that come from the mantle. And we can compare what we see in mantle xenoliths. So here, instead of a crystal that's foreign to the magma, we've got a lith, a chunk of rock like this that's foreign to the magma. So kimberlites can sweep their way up to surface and they can pick up individual crystals like a diamond, for instance, but they can also pick up chunks of rock like this. And we call these xenoliths. This is a chunk of rock from the mantle. So this is a mantle xenolith. And a particularly interesting kind of xenolith is eclogites. Eclogites have a lot of garnet and cladopyroxene in them. Here's a slice through an eclogite that has some striking orange garnets and blue kyanite crystals in it. And when we start looking at diamonds and the inclusions inside, well, we can see examples of all of these minerals that are also represented in mantle xenoliths. So here's an orange garnet in a diamond, and this same diamond has this beautiful blue kyanite crystal. So this is telling us that this diamond grew in an environment that's comparable to that chunk of rock torn up from the mantle. It probably hasn't grown from the kimberlite magma. It's just sort of a passive sort of xenocrist riding its way up to surface and has nothing really in common with the origin of the kimberlite magma itself. Now, let's talk a bit more about kimberlites on the scale of sort of a craton here. Kimberlites don't occur everywhere throughout the Earth. In fact, a lot of the Earth's surface is ocean and ocean floor. We don't seem to find any kimberlites there. Rather, kimberlites seem to be restricted in their geographic location and are strongly correlated with cratons. And cratons are the oldest parts of continents, and they're also the thickest, usually the thickest and coolest parts of continents. Coincidentally, this is where we expect a lot of diamonds to be forming in the sort of base of the oldest, thickest parts of continents, in the cratonic keel, we call it. And this seems to be where diamonds grow, and this also seems to be where a lot of kimberlites erupt. They erupt right through these packages of the continental crust and continental lithospheric mantle. Now, the kimberlite magma itself, we think it's a product of low degree partial melting. So low degree meaning that just a little bit of some rock deeper down has melted, probably 1% or less, just a little bit of melting. And the liquid magma that we see has been extracted from those rocks. And this liquid magma is very rich in volatiles like CO2 and water. The magma originates from below the lithosphere, so it comes from somewhere down below the sort of continent itself, down where the rocks are more squishy and are moving around through geologic time. And these magmas pick up chunks of rocks, and they pick up diamonds, and they pick up lots of other little disaggregated, crumbled up bits of rocks and transport them up to surface. But exactly how they form down here and where they sort of begin remains largely uncertain. Here are sort of four leading ideas as to where this melt might originate. So from one to four, here's number one. This idea posits that maybe we've got a melt that's generated somewhere at the bottom of the lower mantle, maybe at the core mantle boundary, and this melt migrates all the way up through the mantle up to surface. Or maybe number two, where we've got subducting slabs providing perhaps water and CO2 that fluxes some melting in the mantle transition zone. And this is leading to kimberlite magmas that migrate up to surface. Or another idea, maybe there's melt being generated just at the boundary between the lithospheric mantle and the underlying asthenosphere, right at this boundary. Maybe this is where the melt is being generated. Or another idea, maybe the melt has something to do with plumes or ascending material that's either thermally or chemically buoyant and this sort of squishy rock is migrating up closer and closer to surface, and it has some role in triggering melting. That's now, this melt is going to be considered a kimberlite melt. And this is an open question. We don't fully understand this. One of the things that might help us is looking at the ages of kimberlites, because this is not something that happens continuously through Earth history. If we look at the ages of kimberlites, we can see that there are certain episodes in Earth's history where there seem to be more kimberlites than at other times. So kimberlite eruptions seem to be episodic in their nature. This is a time scale stretching from zero, which is today, and these are sort of millions of years before present. So this is going back to 1,000, 2,000, a million years before present. And the Earth on this scale, the age of the Earth would be way back here at 4,500 or 4,600. So it looks like kimberlites are relatively recent in the geological timescale. In fact, many kimberlites, more than half of them, have erupted at an age that's younger than about 250 million years. So maybe it has something to do with more recent geological activity that's giving rise to the eruption of kimberlites. Now, if we can compare these ages, the ages of the kimberlites that bring diamonds up to surface, with the ages of the diamonds themselves that we've learned from studying inclusions and trying to date them radiometrically. So this is a geological time scale here. Now instead, we're going from zero up here, present day, but back farther and farther downwards. So the age of the Earth at 4.6 billion years or so is down below the bottom of the page. But I'll just point out that diamonds, so the oldest diamonds that we know of, seem to be about 3.5 billion years old, or 3,500 million years. So the oldest diamonds are very, very old. And most diamonds that we know of are older than about 500 million years. There are some examples of younger diamonds, but for the most part, we can say that diamonds are fairly old compared to the ages of most kimberlites. Remember, we said that more than half of kimberlites that we know of erupted at a time younger than about 250 million years. So this is another piece of evidence that really suggests very clearly that the diamonds haven't grown from the kimberlite magma, because the diamonds grew and sat around for many millions of years before the kimberlite magma showed up. The kimberlite magma is a much later arrival to this diamond party. So a lot of what we know about kimberlites and diamonds and these ages comes from diamond mining, which we touched on earlier. Here are some examples of diamond mines. So I showed you an aerial view of Diavik, and this is nearby Diavik in northern Canada. This is a mine called Ekati, and it looks similar. It has these open pit mines here where they're sort of digging down into this kimberlite material. And we can see some underground workings here. Here's another open pit. This one, though, this is the Argyle mine. This is actually not a kimberlite. It's like a kimberlite, and for many years it was called a kimberlite. But in more detail, when you study the mineralogy of this rock, it's better classified as a lamproite, and we'll try to come back to this. So let's break it down again here. What exactly is a kimberlite? Because it's not easy. It is a complicated rock. It has a lot of different components to it. And as you saw with the Argyle mine, it's easy to get confused and sort of misname or misidentify rocks. But in its most basic form, a kimberlite is a low-volume, mantle-derived igneous rock. So it's an igneous meaning that it's derived from a molten state as opposed to a sedimentary or a metamorphic rock. So this originates as a melt, a liquid magma. It's ultramafic in its composition, which means that it doesn't have a lot of silica in it, so you never get quartz crystallizing from a kimberlite magma. And it's very magnesium rich. It's got lots of magnesium, which is mostly in these olivine crystals here. It's highly enriched and volatile, so it's got lots of CO2 and water, H2O, in it. And when we look at them, every single time we see a kimberlite, it's always a hybrid rock. It's made up of multiple components. And we can kind of break this down into three main components. We have magmatic phases, things that have crystallized directly from the parental melt, the kimberlite itself. And a lot of the stuff in gray here represents that sort of original magmatic content in this sample of kimberlite here. We also have mantle and crustal xenocrysts. So those are sort of crumbled up bits of rock, little crystals of, here we see lots and lots of olivine, that is olivine xenocrysts. So this is derived from the disaggregation of entrained wall rocks during the magma ascent and emplacement. So as this kimberlite erupted its way to surface, it breaks up a lot of rocks and that stuff gets mixed into the magma and becomes part of it. And the third component we often see in kimberlites is lots and lots of hydrothermal alteration. So all of this stuff is highly reactive with water, and it's that water could be from the magma itself, but you can also have groundwater that's encountered at the surface of the earth. And all of this water causes alteration. The big thing that happens is that olivine gets altered to serpentine, which is a sort of hydrous magnesium silicate. And that changes the texture and feel of the rock itself. All of these three sort of components make a hybrid rock that's very messy and hard to understand. And because of this hybrid nature, it means that the rock we see erupted at surface, we have lots of good reasons to believe that it's different from what it looked like way down here. In fact, what it looked like at 200 kilometers depth, we really don't have a great idea of that. We think that it must have been much more rich in CO2 and water, and it might have even been a more of a carbonatitic type of lava. So full of CO2, and a lot of that CO2 budget might have been used in a sense as an energy source to propel this volcanic eruption all the way up to surface. So that CO2 load might be considered almost like a fuel for this supercharged volcano. Now, coming back to kimberlite and trying to maybe put that definition in slightly different words. So this kimberlite, this is the same section I showed you earlier. It's a complex ultramafic, ultrapotassic. So it's got lots of potassium in it compared to the sodium content. It's a mantle-derived magma rich in CO2 and H2O. It's often crystal rich. So it's got lots of olivines in it and modified by multiple stages of activity near the Earth's surface when it's actually erupting and there's a lot of things happening. Now, because there's a lot of things happening during an eruption, when the pressure decreases rapidly, the temperature drops, you've got groundwater, the most well-preserved kimberlite we can see at Earth's surface is what's called hypabyssal kimberlite. So this is intrusive kimberlite. For instance, kimberlite that has sort of intruded as a sill or some kind of a magmatic body that hasn't erupted at surface, but has been sort of contained deeper in the earth. And that allows it to avoid some of the near surface complications of losing a whole bunch of volatiles and involving a lot of changes in the texture of the kimberlite. So this is sort of the closest, least modified, most original magma we can see at the earth's surface is hypabyssal kimberlite. And if we try to break down the components in more exacting terms, we can say that a kimberlite like this one is made up of, let's say, three main parts. So we said it's lots and lots of olivine. Almost half of it is olivine in a hypabyssal kimberlite. So it's 25% roughly olivine macrocrysts. So these are the sort of rounded clumps or crystals of olivine that have been broken up, where these are the disaggregated rocks from the lithospheric mantle. So imagine we've got rocks that are mostly olivine and they get broken up into lots of tiny little crystals of olivine, and that's transported along with the magma. So kimberlites often have lots and lots of olivine macrocrysts in them. And in addition to these macrocrysts, these disaggregated pieces, we've also got olivine phenocrysts. So phenocryst, meaning that it's grown from the magma itself. And we can see this sort of differentiation in a thin section like this. On the left, this is a sort of rounded piece of olivine that we think was disaggregated and entrained in the magma. But then we've also got more euhedral crystal shapes of olivine labeled with the P here, and the P stands for phenocryst. So we think that some of the olivine in this kimberlite has actually grown from the kimberlite magma itself. So we've got a rock, a magmatic rock with lots and lots of olivine in it. And the rest of it, in this picture, the sort of very fine-grained gray material is what we would call ground mass. This can be a mixture of melt and fluids. And the crystals, if you were to zoom in and try to identify what these crystals are, often you have things like monticellite, phlogopite, spinel, perovskite, serpentine, apatite, and the carbonates, calcite and dolomite. So these are the main components that make the kimberlite a kimberlite in at least the least modified version of a hypabyssal kimberlite. Sometimes we also see bigger crystals, not just macrocrysts that are bigger than about a millimeter, but sometimes we see megacrysts that are bigger than a centimeter or sometimes bigger than 16 millimeters. So a big crystal, and these can be garnets or ilmenites, and these are something unusual that we think forms in the mantle. These are a xenocryst, so they haven't grown from the kimberlite magma, but they've grown from some other kind of metasomatic activity in the mantle. In addition to these components, a very important thing that kimberlites, for our purposes, hopefully contain is kimberlite or diamond indicator minerals. These are xenocrysts, so they've been sort of entrained in the magma, of mineral grains that are associated with diamonds that we sort of find in the same place as diamonds, but which are much more abundant than the diamonds themselves. And these are indicator minerals for the presence of diamonds. So if you want to find diamonds in a kimberlite, you're much better off looking for indicator minerals, because these are sort of going to tip you off that you might have diamonds, but you're much more likely to find the indicator minerals. If you just look for diamond, it can be extremely difficult. You might never find it even in a deposit that is otherwise rich in diamonds. So indicator minerals like this are what people look for when they're looking for a diamond deposit. Maybe they're exploring in glacial tills or alluvial sediments. Quite often they'll take a sample of sediment and try to extract these indicator minerals and count them and plot them up on a map to try to figure out where these indicator minerals have come from. And hopefully that leads us back to a diamond deposit. So some of these minerals that we see, we have garnets, specifically chrome pyrope garnet, that's this beautiful purple color. We've got eclogitic garnets, which tend to be more orange in color. And we've got some chrome diopside, which is this beautiful green color, and oxides like magnesiochromite and picroilmenite. So these are all things that if you found them in a glacial till sample, and they've got the right chemistry like these do, that you would be excited that maybe you're getting closer and closer to a diamond deposit. Now let's take another look at some other kinds of kimberlite besides this sort of simplest case of hypabyssal kimberlite. Here's the same hypabyssal kimberlite that I just showed you. And these are a couple other thin sections of kimberlite. So these are a slice of kimberlite that's being viewed under a microscope. And you can see the scale bar here of 1 millimeter. So these are being viewed fairly close up, and a lot of the constituents we see here are pretty fine grained. Now here, what we saw was little crystals, and so phenocrysts and macrocrysts in some kind of magmatic ground mass that's hypabyssal. So it was an intrusive kind of magma that cooled. Over here on the right, these are a couple other kinds of kimberlite where it's pyroclastic. So the kimberlite has actually fragmented in some way. So it's come up to surface and broken up into pieces rather than just solidifying straight away from that magma. So here, what we can see labeled with an M here, this is M for magma clast. So you can see this dark outline here. This is almost like a blob or a chunk of kimberlite that's now encased within this larger piece of rock, which is itself kimberlite, attesting to the fact that once you get up near surface and you have this sort of explosive eruptive activity where you have volatiles, you have a lot of things happening, the rock texture quickly becomes very complicated. Here's another rock, kimberlite, where we've got M for magma clast, and these magmatic clasts have these little kind of embayments around them because when they sort of accumulated into this whole rock here, these clasts of magma were probably still a little bit molten, and they've changed their shape. They've kind of squished together as opposed to this one, which still sort of maintains this round shape because it probably cooled and had structural integrity. These were still more liquidy when this accumulation of particles settled together in near the top of this volcanic eruption. So hopefully this gives you a sense that these are quite complicated in detail when it comes to looking at all the different things that happen in this eruption. It's an extremely violent place, and we can have multiple eruptive episodes overprinting one another. And another thing I should mention is that we don't typically see the topmost expressions of this volcanic eruption. We don't really see like a mountainous shape of a volcano. And one of the big reasons is that there isn't much to begin with, and that which there is gets eroded away. So most kimberlites are millions of years old, and they've been eroded away to some extent. And what we see is some preserved level, say from here down. And we see examples of sort of this pyroclastics or diatreme facies, but down farther, we can see examples of intrusive magma that has propagated along cracks within the rock, and we would call those kimberlite dikes. So a place where the rock has cracked and it's been infilled with kimberlite magma that's cooled in place. So we get like a sheet of kimberlite as opposed to this kind of crater diatreme carrot shape here. So it does get very complicated once we get close to surface and we start erupting. But there are lots of kimberlites around the world. And we've seen lots of examples of them, of many different styles, different eruptive styles. So globally, there are about 3,500 kimberlites that have been identified, and maybe another 3,000 that are inferred, that exploration companies looking for diamonds think there's another kimberlite there. But they haven't actually gone and drilled into it to really confirm that it's a kimberlite. So there are a lot of kimberlites around the world. Now, remember I said that they're usually associated spatially with cratons. So craton outlines, these old parts of continents, are shown in pink here. In red, these are occurrences of kimberlites. And then in yellow, these are places where diamonds have been mined. Now, in terms of the kimberlites, diamond-bearing kimberlites all around the world, there have been less than 100 that have been mined for diamonds. And a big reason why there is such a discrepancy here between the number of kimberlites we know about and the number we actually mine for diamonds is that most kimberlites don't have diamonds, or at least don't have economic quantities of diamonds. So only about 3% of kimberlites that we actually find turn out to be diamondiferous, here meaning having some kind of a content of diamond or grade that's beyond about 0.01 carats per ton of kimberlite. Or sometimes this is expressed as 1 carat per 100 tons. They're the same. To give you an idea of what a ton of kimberlite might look like, here I've just sort of assumed an average density of 2,500 kilograms per cubic meter. So in this case, a 1 ton of kimberlite would be like a cube that's 74 centimeters on its edge. And if we had a total content of diamonds in that block of rock that accumulated to, that amounts to 1 carat, then we would say that the grade of this kimberlite is 1 carat per ton. And this chart here has diamond grade going up the side here. So here's 1 carat per ton. And on the horizontal axis, this is the value of diamonds. So in any given deposit, we might describe it in terms of how many diamonds are in every ton, in terms of the carats per ton. And we might describe the value of those diamonds in terms of dollars per carat. And this gives you a sense of the value of every chunk of rock that we might pull out of a diamond deposit. And you'll see that there really isn't anything below this dashed line here, which would be considered an ore value of less than $10 per ton. And the reason is because it costs money to mine that chunk of rock and process it and extract the diamonds. So the sort of break-even point is somewhere above here in most cases, where the ore is actually worth closer to 100 tons or $100 per ton. And you can see there's a whole range of kinds of deposits from left to right. For instance, over here on the left, we've got a diamond mine in the Democratic Republic of Congo that has a fairly high diamond grade, but the value is very low. But because it's got the combination of those two, a high grade with a low value, it still is economic. And the reverse of that situation is a place where the diamond grade is very, very low, like at Letseng in Lesotho. But in this case, even though it has a very low grade, the diamonds they do recover there are extremely high value. They're very beautiful, quite often large gemstones that command a very high price. So it too is economic. And you can see some of these most valuable diamond deposits expressed right up here in Russia. There are even some diamond mines where the value of the ore exceeds $1,000 per ton. So you've got a whole range here. And what I'll point out here is a diamond mine that's famous. It's Argyle, but it's not actually a kimberlite. It's a lamproite. Now that brings us to sometimes we talk about kimberlites on their own just to be simple about it, but kimberlites exist in sort of a realm of kimberlites and related rocks. So kimberlites, like we've been talking about, they are mineralogically and geochemically distinct. So we do know exactly where the boundaries are for a kimberlite, but it's very hard to arrive at that boundary in one step. You can never really pick up a rock and just look at it and say, yeah, that's a kimberlite. It takes more work than that. You have to investigate this rock in more detail, describing it in successively increasing increments of detail before you can really say confidently, this rock is a kimberlite. And this can mix you up because there are other rock types of similar texture, composition, and form. And one of those is lamproites. So lamproites like this one in Australia, this is the Argyle mine. This was originally identified as a kimberlite and later reclassified as a lamproite. So it's a little bit different, but the textures are similar, and it also has a lot of olivine in it. So it takes detailed study to be able to differentiate the two. Kimberlites and lamproites have different chemical composition and different mineralogy in detail that allows you to differentiate between the two. And they also have slightly different eruptive styles, and they occur in different tectonic terrains, whereas kimberlites are usually restricted to cratons. Lamproites can occur in younger terrains as well, around the perimeter of cratons. So lamproites like Ellendale and Argyle in Australia are actually economic places for mining diamonds. There's another good example of a diamond-bearing lamproite in the US, in Arkansas, and it's currently the crater of Diamond State Park, where you can go and mine your own diamonds. And that's actually sitting on top of the Prairie Creek lamproite. And in these cases, the lamproite that you see is very olivine rich. It seems to be that when a lamproite is very olivine rich, the chances of it containing diamonds are much higher than a more typical lamproite. Another related rock is what we used to call group two kimberlites. We also called them orangeites for a time. And these are something that are pretty common in Southern Africa, where we have more than 200 occurrences of this kind of rock that's very much like a kimberlite, but has some key differences. For instance, it contains a lot of phlogopite in the rock itself. And a good example of that would be the Finch mine. And this term, orangeite or group two kimberlite, has sort of been discouraged, and it's probably going to be replaced with just calling it lamproite, or specifying that it's a lamproite of the Capval variety. Capval would be the region in southern Africa where we find a lot of these lamproites. But the point is that we think that these are more closely related to lamproites, or olivine-rich lamproites, and should be classified with those rocks. So that's just a bit of an aside to tell you that there are things that are like kimberlites that aren't quite kimberlites. And argyle is a really good example of one of those. Now, I said that sort of describing kimberlites is complicated, and that's true. And there are a lot of people that are exploring for diamonds that need to describe kimberlites, and they need some guidance to sort of help them think about how to categorize diamonds, how to categorize kimberlites, and how to describe them in these sort of increasing levels of sort of investigation before you arrive at that conclusion that it's a kimberlite, and then go beyond that conclusion and describe it further as, well, what kind of a kimberlite is it? Where within this deposit does it occur? How many phases are there? How many different eruptive styles do we see here? So this is a diagram or a chart here taken from a three-part volume recently published by Barbara Scott-Smith and her co-authors, trying to produce a practical guide for people doing this work. And I don't mean for you to read all of this material. I just want you to see that actually describing a kimberlite in detail takes a lot of work, and it takes some sort of disciplined approach where you have to not jump to conclusions, but spend time describing the individual components and mineralogy of that rock before making conclusions, like they did at Argyle, where it was sort of misidentified. It's not really a kimberlite. So one of the ways we might break down kimberlites is here. So aside from breaking them down by composition, you can break them down by the texture of the magma. So I showed you a rock like this. So this is from Snap Lake. This is a hypabyssal kimberlite, so it hasn't erupted. And this is sort of the most well-preserved kind of kimberlite we see. And it's coherent, so it hasn't been broken apart. It's one solid magmatic piece. And that is contrasted by magmas that have sort of broken apart. They've been fragmented, and now the rock is made up of clasts of magma. And this can be broken down further into things that are made up of different kinds of clasts. One of the things that I'm going to talk about in a few slides is this term here, RVK, which is resedimented volcaniclastic kimberlite, where eruption has sort of come up to surface and the material filling that hole has been washed down quite often with water back in to fill the hole. So the volcanic rock we see is almost sedimentary in nature. Now, let's briefly talk about volatiles here, because these are really supercharged volcanoes that are rich in water and CO2. So it's a mantle-derived magma. It means it's actually traversed more than 200 kilometers of rock to arrive at surface. So it needs to have some kind of energy to it to fuel that ascent. And we think a lot of that comes from CO2. And that's why I'm showing this Diet Coke bottle with Mentos dropped in it. And this is exploding to give you a sense of the kind of energy, the eruptive energy behind the CO2 coming out of solution. We said it's very rich in olivine, contains CO2 and water that make it sort of explosive. And we think that this is a key part of how it ascends to surface and breaks up these rocks and eventually comes to surface and excavates this crater. And one individual pipe might have sort of several eruptive episodes that overprint one another and become kind of complicated. We can see evidence of this kind of volatile content in the kimberlite by looking at the textures of diamonds. It's very common for diamonds themselves to be resorbed, and we think that sort of resorption or dissolution of the diamond is largely a function of the water and CO2 content of the kimberlite itself. So we can see the surface of this diamond here and here that's sort of been resorbed. These aren't growth features. These are sort of etched or dissolved into the diamond itself. Here's another example of some etching. These are corrosion sculptures that are kind of irregular in shape. And we think that the shape that's expressed here has more to do with the shapes of the fluids and magma or gases that are butting right up against the surface of this diamond, as opposed to being controlled by the crystal lattice of the diamond itself. And a more extreme version of this is seen here. These are called microdisc patterns. On the left, we've got a pink diamond, and this rough surface shows many little circles that are kind of overprinted multiple times. On the right, we've got a more zoomed in image from a scanning electron microscope. We see all these little depressions that are circles. And what we think this is caused by is the presence of bubbles. So you can think of this diamond almost as being coated in bubbles in much the same way that this lime wedge here is coated in bubbles from this fizzy drink. So this is a volatile rich fluid that is exsolving some bubbles here. We think something like this might be happening to give rise to this texture, this surface texture in some diamonds, that we had bubbles being exsolved out of the kimberlite magma, and they're either preferentially etching away or sometimes maybe even protecting the diamond surface just locally around where that bubble is adhered. So I mentioned that according to the volatile content and the sort of eruption pathway and the rocks that the kimberlite encounters at surface, we can have lots of different kinds of kimberlites. The way they evolve in this eruption can depend quite heavily on the geology of the rocks near surface where this kimberlite is erupting. And here we've got three different eruptive styles that are expressed within Canadian kimberlites. One that we might see at Fort Alicorn here, another that we might see at like a Diavik and Akati, and here a kind of eruption style we might see at Gachoquet. Now I'd like to talk a little bit about this one because I think it's more interesting. This mine here, the Akati mine, I actually had the privilege of going there and seeing some of these rocks up close. And I want to tell you something that I found pretty fascinating about this kind of rock, which is labeled here. Many of these units are RVK. This is resedimented kimberlite. So remember, it's been sort of erupted out of this pipe and been washed back in by gravity or water. And these rocks that we see now are sort of pseudo-sedimentary in origin. And one of the things that we can get sort of washed back in here is not just the original rocks that got blasted out of this hole, but we can get plant matter, we can get trees. So we can actually find wood fragments sometimes in here. And the wood is actually not fossilized. It's not turned into stone or petrified. So this contrasts really, really interestingly with rocks, for instance, here at Yellowstone. So this is petrified wood. This is like a stump of a tree that's 55 million years old. And the eruptive activity here, so this has sort of been buried by volcanic ash, and percolation of water and silica has turned the wood into stone, essentially. It's petrified. So this fossil wood here is very hard. It's siliceous. It's stony. But if you look at the wood that we see at Akati, which is also around 55 million years old, this is not petrified at all. It's well preserved. You could take this wood and carve it with a knife. You could light it on fire. You can smell it, and it smells like a piece of organic matter. And it's really quite fascinating that all of this material sort of was falling down back into this huge excavated crater. And because of the immense amount of material that's piled up on top, it was just preserved. It hasn't been rotted away, and it hasn't been petrified in any way. It's preserved wood of some, I believe these are trees related to sequoias. So a lot of what we've learned about kimberlites Even though we've been mining kimberlites for a while, the sort of modern revolution of study into kimberlites really started in 1973. There was a book published by Peter Nixon on the kimberlites of Lesotho, and also in 1973, this was when the first international kimberlite conference was, that brought together experts from all around the world to talk about diamonds and talk about kimberlites and exploration for these things. And this kimberlite conference continues today. Every 4 years or so, there's a kimberlite conference, and it just so happens the next one is coming up next year. It's going to be in Yellowknife, and something that I'm really looking forward to, and I plan to attend. And if you have any interest in kimberlites at all, I would encourage you to attend as well. If you have some interest but don't want to attend this conference, I can recommend some further reading here. So in 2019, there was a snippet from Gems in Gemology. You can find it at this address here. It talks about a lot of the things that I've been talking about in this talk, but in more detail. So it's a really nice read. And if you'd like to dig even deeper, I would recommend this nice review issue in Elements that talks about all things kimberlites and the latest and greatest findings, and sort of puts them together in one comprehensive package. So a lot of the stuff that I've talked about and some of the figures that I've shown are from this issue of Elements. So what is a kimberlite? A kimberlite is this complex, ultramafic, ultrapotassic, igneous rock. So it formed from a magma, but this is a mantle-derived magma, and it's rich in volatiles, CO2 and water, which are part of what makes it so explosive. It's very abundant. It's got lots of olivine in it. So in hypabyssal kimberlite, we see upwards of 50% olivine, macrocrysts, and phenocrysts. And quite often, these kimberlites form these volcanic pipes that we mine near surface, as well as dikes and sills. So places where magma has filled in a crack or maybe a space between rock layers. And even though many kimberlites don't contain diamonds, sometimes they do, and the grades can be anywhere from 0.01 all the way up to 10 carats per ton of rock. So we have enough diamonds here to make it an economic deposit in some cases. And importantly, one of the things we've learned is that diamonds are not xenocrysts. So they're not really crystallized from the kimberlite magma. The diamonds grew probably many, many millions of years before the kimberlite even showed up. And the kimberlites are like elevators that diamonds ride all the way up to surface. Quite an exciting elevator, I'd say. And with that, I'd like to take any questions.
Well, thank you, Evan. That was a lot of interesting information. We have a number of questions. We'll get to a few of them here. I've gotten several in particular regarding, why do diamonds survive in kimberlites? Why do they not melt? And does that have something to do with the speed of eruption or how fast kimberlites erupt? Do you want to speak to that a little bit?
Yeah, no, that's a great question. It probably is the case that some kimberlites actually digest all of the diamonds that might have been in there. I mean, we see evidence for a lot of resorption or oxidization of diamonds in many kimberlites. So they've sort of, on their way up to surface, have slowly been eaten away at by the sort of corrosive activity of the kimberlite magma. But it's important to recognize that the diamond is sort of being chemically eaten away. It's being oxidized as opposed to being melted. The diamond has a very, very high melting temperature. In fact, I don't think there's anywhere in the mantle realistically where a diamond is going to melt. So the diamonds aren't melting. They're not in any danger of being melted. They're at a danger of being oxidized and sort of being slowly dissolved away. One of the other things that might happen is that they might transfer from the diamond crystal structure to the graphite crystal structure. I don't think we see great evidence for that happening in kimberlites, but they are leaving the diamond stability field. Once they come up to surface and they're sitting there in this hot kimberlite, they're far outside of the stability field for diamond, and they've entered the stability field for graphite. And if the temperature is held very high for long enough, you could potentially have some transition or reversion, graphitization of that diamond material. So it goes from diamond to graphite. But the big thing is the resorption. And maybe the resorption is so pronounced in so many kimberlites, and maybe that's the reason why so many kimberlites don't contain diamonds.
So, I mean, most volcanic magmas move relatively slowly. The notion then is the kimberlites move very, very quickly, right? Do you have any detailed information about that?
Yeah, sorry, I didn't touch on the speed, but the speed is probably important too. They're traveling a long way. We think that a lot of these kimberlites are traveling at least 200 kilometers all the way up to surface, and they've got this precious diamond cargo with them. If the diamond is being chemically eroded, you know, this is sort of like a race against time to get the diamond to surface. We think that most kimberlite eruptions occur maybe on the course of hours or days. So the magma is moving relatively quickly up to surface compared to other kinds of magma, like in some of the volcanoes I was showing you in the very beginning. We think that kimberlite magma moves very quickly.
Yes, they're pretty fascinating rocks. Let's see, we have a few more. One viewer or listener was particularly interested in whether we see different concentrations of diamonds in different parts of a kimberlite pipe.
Yeah, absolutely. And that's one of the biggest challenges. Once, you know, let's say you're exploring for diamonds and you're lucky enough to find a kimberlite pipe that contains diamonds, now you've got to identify all the different phases within that kimberlite. So you might have a single pipe that has one eruption and then another eruption through that, and then some kind of slumping material back into the crater, and then another eruption through that. And all of these different pulses of magma could potentially have different diamond budgets that they bring with them. So even though the kimberlite as a whole is diamondiferous, all of those diamonds might be concentrated in only one of the units of this eruption. So it takes a lot of energy to sort of understand the three-dimensional distribution of all these different phases and work out what the grade is of all those different rock units within the pipe. So there's a lot of work to be done to figure out that spatial geometry of the grade. That's very important because as you're mining it, you really need to know, you know, is this scoop of material very diamondiferous, or is this waste? Or, you know, if you need to bring more diamonds to the mill, you need money now, you need to know where to go in the pipe to find your best diamonds. It's a really complicated problem.
Yeah, and I think there's a lot of work going on in some of the mines like Letting to try and figure out what parts of the pipe bigger diamonds as well, not just the higher concentrations. Yeah.
Yeah, absolutely.
So there's several questions. A lot of people are interested in where the potassium comes from, what mineral phases it's stored in, but more specifically, why do you have so much potassium in these magmas that are thought to derive so deep in the earth?
Okay, so we talked about the kimberlite being a low degree melt. So you might have a lot of rock material and you melt just a little bit of it and extract this melt. Potassium is a very incompatible element. So as soon as you start forming a melt from a rock, the potassium will partition into that rock. And as it comes to surface, this kimberlite magma is full of a lot of potassium because it's full of all kinds of incompatible elements. And when it gets to the surface and it starts crystallizing phases, the potassium will most strongly be concentrated in phlogopite. So we actually see phenocrysts of like phlogopite mica inside kimberlite. And when you pick up a piece of kimberlite, sometimes people see these sparkly flashes from it and think those are the diamonds, but it's usually the phlogopite. In fact, in most cases, even if you're lucky enough to be allowed to tour a diamond mine, you can pick up all kinds of pieces of kimberlite and not see any diamonds because all of this material needs to be processed. Because even in a place where the diamond grade is pretty high, you're still talking about a large volume of rock that needs to be broken up and sorted through to find that one individual diamond there.
Definitely a lot of work goes on in recovering these things. So.
Yeah.
I had another question, and it's something we don't talk about all that often. We talk about gem size diamonds, but this viewer is asking about micro diamonds. Do you want to comment on micro diamonds just very briefly?
So, for jewelry, we're interested in diamonds that are, you know, larger than a millimeter or two that we can actually cut and polish into gemstones. But when you look at a piece of kimberlite, quite often we have many, many more very tiny diamonds we call micro diamonds that are smaller than a millimeter or smaller than half a millimeter, depending on what cutoff you're using. And those micro diamonds, even though we don't recover them for use as gemstones, they're an important part of trying to assess how many diamonds are in this given unit of kimberlite. Because we have so many more of those, we can sort of use a statistical approach and say, okay, we have a lot of micro diamonds, that means we probably have a lot of macro diamonds, and try to work out or estimate what the grade might be based on those really, really tiny, tiny diamonds.
Pretty valuable exploration tool, I would think.
Yeah.
Yeah, decision making. All right, so maybe one last quick question regarding ages. You talked about how diamonds are much older and kimberlites are much younger. Are there kimberlites erupting today? And if not, do you know what the oldest known kimberlite eruption, the youngest known kimberlite eruption is?
Yeah, so the answer is no, we don't see anything erupting today that we would consider to be a kimberlite. The youngest thing that might be a candidate is called Iguisi Hills in Tanzania, and that's 12,000 years old, which is very young, but there's not a whole lot of consensus on whether it is or isn't a kimberlite. It's sort of kimberlite-like, but it's still under study. And older than that, I think the next oldest true kimberlite is closer to 30 million years old.
So in the Congo, I think, right? Somewhere?
I think so, yeah. And then you've got some kimberlites that are as old as maybe 2.8 billion years. So you've got a lot of Earth history where we had kimberlites erupting. But right now, we just haven't seen any go off within recorded history.
All right. Well, with that, I think we'll wrap up the questions. Thank you again, Evan. If you have any additional questions that didn't get answered, please find GIA on Instagram, Facebook, LinkedIn, and Twitter. Thank you all for coming, and please join us next week. Next week, we will be joined by GIA Supervisor of Field Gemology, Wim Vertriest, who will be discussing the natural processes that form colored gemstones. I think this is a follow-up to a talk he gave on ruby, sapphire, and emerald earlier, so should be a lot of good information. Once again, thank you to Dr. Evan Smith for his excellent presentation. And thank you all for attending. Goodbye.
Bye-bye.